Within biological organisms, molecular concentrations of proteins and chemicals can be very low. Scientists must dilute out their samples before exposing them to cells, and serial dilution, the stepwise dilution of a sample in solution, is the quickest way of doing this. We will go over some basic calculations and the hands-on techniques you need to maximize the accuracy of each dilution. When calculating a serial dilution, there are three key pieces of information that you need to consider. The first is the dilution factor. Is the sample going to be diluted 1 in 2, 1 in 5, 1 in 10? This dilution factor can be any ratio of sample to diluent and is the same for each dilution as in series. Next is reaction volume, which is the total volume of sample and diluent when they are being mixed. This volume is the same for every dilution in the series as well. The final piece of information needed is the number of dilutions that need to be made. You determine this by figuring out the endpoint or the final concentration of your sample after all the dilutions. We then work backwards from there to determine the total number of dilutions needed. To see how serial dilution works in practice, let's look at two examples. The first is a simple dilution of red food coloring dye. We'll use a dilution factor of 1 in 10, a reaction volume of 100 microliters, and we will perform 6 dilutions in total. We divide the total reaction volume of 100 microliters by the dilution factor of 10 to arrive at the volume of sample needed in each dilution. 100 microliters divided by 10 equals 10 microliters, so we need to add 10 microliters of sample in each dilution. To make up the total volume to 100 microliters, we add 90 microliters of diluent to every dilution. Given that there are 6 dilutions in total, add 90 microliters of water to 6 wells in the plate. Then pipette 10 microliters of the food dye and add this to the first well. This is the first 1 in 10 dilution, and now this well has 100 microliters of reaction volume. The reaction needs to be thoroughly mixed, and you can do this by pipetting up and down a number of times. When you're convinced that the first dilution is homogenized, remove 10 microliters from this well and pipette this into the second well, which also contains 90 microliters. This is the second 1 in 10 dilution, and now this well has 100 microliters of reaction volume. Thoroughly mix again by pipetting up and down. We repeat this process until we have performed 6 1 in 10 serial dilutions. You can visualize the effects of the dilution through the decreasing color intensity across the 6 wells. Sounds simple enough, right? In reality, this process is very error-prone, as there are many steps involved. Watch the next demonstration carefully and see if you can spot the mistakes being made. Did you notice it? All it takes is for one dilution to not be homogenized or mixed thoroughly, and all of the remaining dilutions are compromised. Now, let's look at a more practical example. Since a bacterial culture can have trillions of cells, extremely high dilutions are required to separate them out. In this example, we want to perform 1 in 10 serial dilutions of E. coli cultures in a total reaction volume of 10 milliliters. We want to perform 6 dilutions altogether. We divide the total reaction volume of 10 milliliters by the dilution factor of 10 to arrive at the volume of sample needed in each dilution. 10 milliliters divided by 10 equals 1 milliliter, so we need to add 1 ml of bacterial culture to each bottle. To make up the total volume to 10 mls, we need to add 9 mls of sterile saline in each dilution. To visualize the effect of the serial dilutions, we will plate out each bottle onto an agar plate to observe the number of bacterial colonies that grow. This time, let's look at the results first. We have two sets of results, A and B. Take note of the differences in bacterial colony numbers as the serial dilutions progress from 10 to the negative 1 all the way through to 10 to the negative 6. Now let's watch two versions of the serial dilution, 1 and 2. I want you to match up the demonstrations to the end result. Which one do you think led to which result? You can skip back and forth to rewatch the demonstrations until you convince yourself which one is which. The answer is on screen now. One demonstration failed to mix the reaction volumes after each dilution, the same mistake we observed earlier in the food dye dilutions. This will lead to inconsistent bacterial colony numbers that do not decrease along with the serial dilutions. If we watch the correct demonstration again in sequence, you can see 9 mL of saline is pre-aliquoted out into 6 bottles. 1 mL of the original bacterial culture is added into the first saline bottle. The bottle is vortexed to thoroughly homogenize the sample. There is now a total reaction volume of 10 mL in this bottle, so this is the first 1 in 10 dilution. 1 mL is then extracted from this bottle and added to the next 9 mL bottle of saline. Again, we homogenize by vortexing, and this is the second 1 in 10 dilution. This process is repeated across all 6 bottles. Take care that there are no air bubbles or extra drops of liquid on the outside of the pipette tip, and homogenize after each dilution. This is how we can generate accurate serial dilutions, which results in clear, gradual decrease in bacterial colony numbers across serially diluted plates. Serial dilution is the most efficient and accurate means of making large dilutions with small but manageable volumes. You should now know the basic calculations involved, as well as common mistakes to avoid.